I am Shashi Tiwari, professor in Sanskrit, Maitreyi College, University of Delhi. In my previous lectures, we have discussed Vedic literature and later Vedic literature. Today in this lecture, we will be discussing about Vedic religion. Vedic religion is a vast subject. It includes ritualistic, philosophical and cultural views of Vedic sages, Vedic thinkers, to whom we say Vedic rishis. It contains a treasury of spiritual laws that were discovered and realized by unknown number of sages and saints over many years. Later they were compiled into Vedic texts and Upanishads. And in addition to various other literature was also developed, and all this contains points and some aspects of Vedic religion. In fact, Vedas are revelations. They are a part of Shabda Brahma. They are spiritual vibrations, and according to Indian traditions, Vedas were visualized by seers or sages in their deep stage of meditation, and they use their eyes of intelligence for revealing them. So they are a high spiritual documents and most sacred and most authentic. All these were revealed for the benefit of humanity and mankind. When we are discussing Vedic religion, in fact, we are discussing the various aspects of Vedic wisdom. Before starting, we should know the region of Vedic Aryans. This is a picture of North Eastern India, and here you can see few rivers are there as Vitasta, Shatudri, Saraswati, Kubha, Vipasha, Sindhu and Ganga Yamuna. So this region was called the region of Vedic Aryans, and in general way we say it Aryavart. So this was the region where Vedic civilization and Vedic culture was flourished. Now we will be starting our main aspects dealing Vedic religion. Because it is a wide subject, so only major aspects or key principles can be discussed here. First is aim of life, aim of human life. If we ask a simple question from anyone, what is the aim of life? Everyone will reply, happiness. But when we will ask, what is the definition of happiness? Then people will reply variously. Someone will say wealth is happiness. Someone will say career is happiness. Someone may say family or children are happiness. Some will be telling that intelligence is happiness. But according to Indian Vedic tradition, happiness has two parts. One is its inner part, and the second is its outer part. It has three levels: physical, mental and spiritual. Or we can say that happiness has three dimensions. One is which deals with individual, the second is which deals with society, and the third is which deals with family. So all this should be happy. This should be happy. That's why Vedic rishis think that human being should be happy physically, mentally and spiritually. And that is the reason we find various prayers in mantras for prosperity, for long life, wealth, intelligence, family, children, food, peace and welfare of all human beings. So a good and satisfied life is the aim of a human life according to Vedic mantras, according to the views of Vedic seers. But this is not the highest goal. Highest goal of the life is, according to the mantras, moksha. And it can be defined as liberation or salvation or union with the Brahman. So this is the highest goal, and how it can be achieved. It can be obtained, it can be achieved only through knowledge, only through self-realization. That is the reason there are numerous quotations in the Upanishads which say when self is joined with Brahman, that is salvation. When self is free from the bondage of life, that is salvation. When there is no cycle of death and birth, that is salvation. So this stage, which is the highest stage, which is the highest goal of human life, according to the Vedic scriptures, that can be achieved only by knowledge, by the knowledge of self, Atmagyan. Mundaka Upanishad says, Brahmavit Brahmeva Bhavati. When you know Brahma, you become Brahma. You are a part of Brahma. So this is the highest goal, and means for getting this goal is self-knowledge. Simply we can say that self-knowledge leads to highest goal, moksha. But what is the role of actions or sacrifices which are described in Brahmanas, in Aranyakas, and in detail, in length, then what is the use of that? Then Vedic view says that all those works which are pious works, which are sacrifices, which are for the welfare of humankind, they all lead to Swarga, which is divine pleasure. So a complete life, human beings, a complete life goal should be worldly pleasure, heavenly pleasure, and liberation. Finally, liberation. So this is the first aspect which must be very clear when we study about Vedic religion. The second aspect which I will like to discuss under the banner of Vedic religion is belief in one supreme entity. According to Upanishads, according to Vedic mantras, Atman and Brahman are the same. They are synonyms. They indicate towards one entity, that is supreme entity, which is called absolute truth. In other words, we can say Sat Chit Anand. What is Sat? That is absolute truth. Chit, that is absolute consciousness. And Anand, that is absolute bliss. So this is the nature of Brahman. He is most powerful. He is omnipresent. He is supreme reality. So this Brahman and Atman, which we generally call self, are the same. This should be very clear when we study about Vedic religion. And something more, if we will say, and if we would like to define by quotations, then there is a saying in Chandogya Upanishad, Tattvamasi, where Rishi says to Shvetaketu that, O Shvetaketu, the whole world consists of it, that are you, Tattvamasi. And that Brahman is manifested in all beings and it is present in everywhere. How it can be possible that he is present everywhere but he is not seen? So for illustration, a reference from a Upanishad can be given here, which says that this can be understood by example. If you take a solid piece of salt and put it in a bucket full of water, after some time that salt will be assimilated in the whole water. So now salt will not be seen, but each drop will be salty. So like that, Brahman is present everywhere, but it is not seen by anyone. So this was about that supreme entity. Then there is a reference in Ishavasya Upanishad. It is the first verse which goes like that. Ishavasyam idam sarvam yat kincha jagatyam jagat tena tyaktena bhunjitha magridhah kasya svidvanam. All this, whatever there is changeful in this changing universe, is enveloped by the Lord. So He is all-pervading. He envelops everything, every part of universe. This is the message, this is the concept which Upanishad wants to highlight through this mantra. The another quotation from Brihadaranyaka Upanishad says, Aham Brahma Asmi, I am Brahman. So again, self and Brahman are identified. In Rig Veda, a very famous sukta is Purusha Sukta. Its first mantra says, Sahasra Sirshaha Purushaha, Sahasra Akshaha, Sahasra Pat, Sah Bhumim Vishwato Vritva, Atyatishthat Dashangulam. The perfect being has thousands of heads, thousands of eyes, thousands of feet. Having pervaded the whole earth on all sides, he remains 10-finger in surplus because he is endless. So this is a picture of Virat Purush. This is a picture which says that Brahmand is the outer form of Brahman. But if anyone will be thinking that he knows universe, so he may know Brahman, then the Veda says no, you can't know him because he is surplus. He is out of that universe also. So how you will be knowing out of it when what is before the beginning and after the end? So in simple words, it is very difficult to understand the real nature of Brahman. Vedas emphasizes several times on this concept. As a term is used, neti neti. Neti, neti. It means that this is not Brahman, this is not Brahman, this is not Brahman. So if one will be pointing out that this is Brahman, is it Brahman? So the Veda will say, no, it is not Brahman, it is not Brahman. So what is the reason? Because when we know anything, we know it through our senses. Or we think about it through our mind. But that concept, that supreme concept is above thought, above sense organs, because he is not an object. So, in short, we can say that that is absolute reality, real reality, that highest truth, spiritually the supreme power that is beyond our knowledge. But through realization, one can pursue it, one can know it, and that is known as Atmagyan or self-knowledge, self-realization. Again, from Rig Veda, an important mantra can be quoted here. It is Hiranyagarbha Sukta, and the first mantra is Hiranyagarbha Samvartatagre Bhutasya Jataha Patirekasit. This Hiranyagarbha is different from Purush or from Brahma, because it is said that it is the first concept which was created from that Brahman. Hiranyagarbha Samvartatagre. It was the firstly produced concept in the creation. So other things were created from Hiranyagarbha. So he was born as a sole lord of all beings. So these there are various highest spiritual concepts which are described in Upanishads, in Rig Vedic mantras, in Athar Vedic mantras, and all say that all this is Purush, all this is Brahman. As Rig Veda has said, Purush eva idam sarvam, everything which we see, which we, all beings, all creatures, all human beings are part of that Supreme Lord. So this was about non-dualistic approach of Vedic sages, and they emphasize on the concept of oneness. Now we will be talking about a different concept, importance of action and knowledge. What is the importance of action and knowledge? As has been said earlier, that knowledge is important for achieving moksha or salvation. Then what is the role of actions, which are prescribed there? As a human being, everyone has to perform actions, have to work, have to be busy all the time. So, for leading a long life, actions are prescribed in the Vedas, in the Aranyakas and the Upanishad. There is emphasis that one should desire a life of 100 years. Jivem Sharda Shatam. One should desire a long life, a healthy life, a life full of all activities. Then, but what will be the purpose of that life? Ishavash Upanishad says that lead a good life, lead a long life, but always performing actions. Kurvannevi karmani jijivishet shatam shamaha. Only by performing actions, one should desire to live a life of 100 years on this earth. So this should be the motto. Along with action, one should pursue knowledge, and along with knowledge, one should try to know what is his actions, and he should be always performing righteous works, righteous deeds in his life. Regarding this importance of action and knowledge in Vedic religion, here I will like to give a reference of Kathopanishad, and this Upanishad is a very popular Upanishad. It related with Yajurveda, and it mentions a story in the very beginning. And the story is about a Rishi Vajashrava and his young son Nachiketa. So the story says that Vajashrava performed a yajna which was called Sarvamedha Yajna, and it requires that all the possession and all the wealth should be given away to Brahmanas or to other needy persons. So accordingly, Vajashrava has distributed all his wealth to Brahmanas and to other persons. But due to his affection towards his younger son, young son Nachiketas, he hold few good cows, and instead of those, he started giving away some weak and old cows as a dakshina. Nachiketa observed this thing. He thought that my father is not doing a right thing. In this, by doing all these wrong actions, he will be going to Narak. He may be far away from Sarga. So he thought, and after some time, he asked his father, Kasmai mam dasyasi, to whom are you going to give me? To whom you are going to give me? And he said this sentence thrice. Then finally, his father was annoyed, and he replied that Mrityuve tvam dadami, I am giving you to Lord of Death, I am giving you to Yam. And later on, Nachiketas decided that he will go to Yamraj, he will go to the place, to the abode of Nachiketas, to the Yamraj. And finally, he reached there. Then, when he reached there, Yamraj was not at home. So, he waited for him 3 days. And when he reached at his home, he realized that he has done a mistake, because a young student or a young child was sitting over his outside his house. So, he felt sorry. And to remove this mistake, he offered Nachiketas that you ask me 3 boons. And then Nachiketas asked three boons. So I will like to discuss them in sequence. First boon was that my father should be happy and he should be in mental peace. And when I will be back at home, he should welcome me and he should recognize me. So this boon was granted by Yamraj. Then by second boon, he asked about the knowledge of the divine fire. And this is Karmakanda, because through this knowledge of divine fire, he will be able to get a place in Swarga. So again, Yamraj granted this boon. And then by third boon, Yamraj has to give him the Atma Gyan, because Nachiketas has asked that please give me the knowledge of Brahman, please give me the knowledge of Atma, because finally my goal of life is moksha, salvation, liberation. So after several times he insisted upon the same boon, and then finally Yamraj has to grant him this Atmagyan. So here comes the sequence and the significance of that sequence. What is the significance of this sequence? Firstly, this story gives us the message that firstly, we should be satisfied in our family, in our worldly pleasures. We should lead a qualified, quality life, a satisfied and prosperous life. Then secondly, we should think about second life, a good life, which we can lead in Swarga, and that is called Swarga Prapti, and this is second stage of any man's achievements. Then third should be finally one should know about Brahman, about Atman. So the sequence is very important because these are the three steps through which one can climb up to the highest level in a life. And through this story also we came to know the importance of action in the life and also the importance of knowledge in the life. Both are important. Actions are important for getting worldly pleasures, for getting heavenly pleasures. But knowledge is important for getting self-realization. Different fruits are defined and prescribed in Brahmanas and Aranyakas. Different rituals are there. So if one will perform a particular ritual, through that one can obtain that result. So like that in Aranyakas and Upanishad, there are numerous yajnas and ceremonies prescribed. As one ceremony is called Jyotishtoma, and the quotation is that Swargakamo Jyotishtomo Swargakamo Yajet. If one wants to get Swarga, he should perform Jyotishtoma. So every yajna or ritual has its definite fruits or results. So actions are very important, but knowledge or spiritual upliftment is also very important. And this is a basis of Vedic religion. The third aspect which I would like to deal in this subject is purification of mind. Vedas emphasize on the purity of mind, on the cleanliness of mind. Our thoughts should be very good, because good thoughts leads to good actions only. And my mind has tremendous power. There are tremendous power. Mind can go sitting over a place. Mind can travel far away. There are other things also which are defined about mind in Shiva Sankalpa Sukta. As one can perform actions only through mind. One can think about any good thing. One can read a book only through mind. One can concentrate only through mind. So everything depends on mind. So it has tremendous power. It is most powerful. It can go anywhere. It can think about any object. And it is illuminator of our senses also, because if I wants to catch a object, then mind should be there. If ear want to catch a sound, then mind should be there. So it is called Jyotisham Jyotihi. It is the Jyoti of all Jyotis. It is the illuminator of all our senses. So this is the importance of mind. And if one can control mind, if one can purify mind, his deeds will automatically be good. His life will be going to a very good path towards a good goal. So that is the reason purification of mind is prescribed in the Vedic texts. They say Shiva Sankalpa is very important. Shiva means auspicious, Sankalpa means resolution. And Yajurveda's a famous sukta is there, Shiv Sankalpa Sukta. Every mantra repeats a same sentence, Tanme Manaha Shiv Sankalpa Mastu. My mind be a good resolution. Because if good resolution can only lead to good actions, and good actions can lead to good results. So emphasis of purification of mind, emphasis of cleanliness of mind, mental thoughts and feelings and sentiments, all this is very, very important according to Vedic religion and Vedic philosophy. In the Rig Veda, there is a mantra which says, Kamastadagre samvartatati manasoreta prathamam yatasit. In the very beginning, kam was there, desire was there. And what is this desire? This desire is the first seed of mind. So, mind is important because mind has all these desires and attachments and good or bad feelings. So, it should be very, very pure, and purity of mind is, that is the reason purity of mind is emphasized. If mind is filled with good thoughts, with good sentiments, with good feelings, then definitely he will be leading towards good goal, good results. Another aspect of Vedic religion, nature worship. And I would like to connect it with Vedic deities and Vedic symbolism. Vedic nature worship, then Vedic deities and Vedic symbolism. These are actually the three parts of a concept which should be clear when we are going to study Vedic religion. As we all know, Vedic Aryans were nature worshipper. They were the children of nature. They have seen the nature's drama very minutely. They have observed there was sometimes thunderstorm, sometimes intense lightning, sometimes rains were there, sometimes heat, plants, trees, rivers, mountains. So they were attracted towards all these natural powers, natural aspects, natural activities. And they were appreciating them also. They were having a regard for them also because they were beneficial for them. They were giving something to them for their livelihood, for their good living. So, finally, they attributed divinity to nature. This is the point which has to be underlined, that they attributed divinity to nature, and the reason was they were having regard for natural powers, or they were surprised towards the activities of nature, or they may have fear also, if any natural power will be annoyed, it may create disaster. So, due to regard, surprise and fear, they attributed divinity to natural powers, to natural aspects or to natural activities. I say activities also because rain is an activity, rain is not an aspect, but sun is an aspect. Earth is an aspect. So, power, activities and aspects, all of related with nature, were described as deities. This is a very simple explanation of Vedic deities when we study about Vedic deities. And here it must be noted that it is not a very easy subject. Vedic deities, Vedic devata, divinity, this is not an easy subject. This aspect is described by various Vedic scholars in various ways. According to some, Vedic devatas are powers of nature, as we have just spoken about it. Some will say that no, all these deities are different names of that supreme power. Indra, Mitra, Varuna, Nasatya, Surya, Prithvi, all these are forms of that supreme power. Then there is a view which says that no, all these powers, all these divinities which are listed in Vedic mantras, they are within ourselves, as our eyes are representative of Surya, our breath is the representative of Vayu, water inside our body is representative of water. So like that. So all which is outside in the Brahmand is inside in our body. Yatha pinde tatha Brahmande. So all deities belongs to our body also. So like that, few names are repeated all the time. There are numerous mantras assigned to these deities, as Agni is the first, Indra second, Vayu, Earth, Som, Varuna, Vishnu, Aditya, Ushas, Aditi, Parjanya, and so on. So Agni, you everyone know Agni is the fire. Indra is the rain god. In general terms, Vayu, it is air. Earth, it is Prithvi, that is Earth. Som is a plant, very sacred plants, which was used in rituals and which was offered to deities during ceremonies. Then Varun Dev is there, who is a controller of the whole cosmic order. Vishnu is a deity, very important deity. It is an all-pervading concept related with the Surya. Aditya is there, it is a name for sun god. Ushas is there, which is dawn, which comes in the morning and which destroyed the darkness, which is spread over in the sky. Aditi, it is an abstract deity. Parjanya, which is a cloud. So generally, these natural elements are defined as Vedic deities. And absolute meaning or the inner hidden meaning of the Vedic deities should be also understand that we don't believe, or Vedic rishis don't believe, in many powers, in many deities. But they say that all these deities are part of that absolute Brahman, supreme power. So these are the form of that one power. So in fact, as we have told earlier, that they believe in one entity. So Vedic deities, because we are telling about many deities, so no one should be confused about this, that there are so many gods. No, they are not gods, but they are different forms of one god. And because nature is one, so all these deities are representatives of that supreme power. That is the reason Rig Veda says, and it is a famous mantra, Ekam Sad Vipraha Bahudha Vadanti. Ekam Sad, there is only one absolute truth, but Vipraha, scholars define it variously. Bahudha Vadanti, they say about it in various terms, in various ways. So Vedic deities are only simplification to understand that supreme reality. And here comes the third point, which was related with nature worship and Vedic deities, that is Vedic symbolism. What is Vedic symbolism? Generally, there are so many concepts, there are so many terms, there are so many aspects which are symbolic. In fact, Vedic language is a symbolic language. We cannot draw meanings directly from the words. What is written there, that is the meaning. No, it something hidden is there. Some inner meaning is also there. So deities should be worshipped. It is said the deities should be worshipped because they are helpful. They are essential. They are our part. They are part of our environment. But they are assigned many characteristics, many qualities. As sun is light, sun is dispenser of darkness. As Varun is a controller of the whole universe. He controls, he is a very disciplined deity. So we should understand that if we are asking knowledge from sun god, it means we are understanding that he symbolizes brilliance, he symbolizes light, and light is knowledge. So Gayatri mantra, everyone knows that Gayatri mantra, tat savitur varenyam bhargo devasya dhimahi dhiyo yo nah prachodayat. This is a mantra for Savita Dev, Surya Deva, and here request has been done for grant of intelligence. And what he is saying, worshipper is saying that he is meditating on the brilliance of the sun. So from brilliance, which represents, which symbolizes knowledge, again he is asking for intelligence. So if he will be asking for intelligence and he will be praying sun god, which symbolizes knowledge and brilliance, so automatically he will try to get it, he will put some efforts for knowing that. Likewise, we can understand Vedic symbolism as in various mantras, chakra is a form used variously, chakra. So chakra means wheel, and wheel means movement. If there is a talk about water, then water symbolizes flow. If there is a talk about darkness, tamas, then it means it is talking about ignorance. So this is symbolism, and Sri Arvind Ghosh has very, very carefully explained all this symbolism in his books, and that is a very deep meaning of Vedic mantras. And if one can understand it, it will be better, because from where nature worship, through coming through Vedic deities, we have to go up to Vedic symbolism, which is a difficult subject, but trying one can understand it, and then it will be very clear what was the concept of Vedic symbolism in Vedic religion. Now comes something we will be talking about, Vedic rituals. Here is a picture of Vedic ritual. Yajna has been performed on Vedic altar. Fire is lit there, and a purohit is sitting, who is called Ritvij. So all these various rituals are the subject matter of Brahmanas and Aranyakas, about which we have talked in our earlier lecture, which was about later Vedic literature. So these Vedic rituals are also a very important part of Vedic religion, because definite influence will be provided by Vedic rites and Vedic rituals. Yajna, by chanting mantras, by special offerings, all these things are based on scientific principles. In simple ways, I will like to explain about yajna. When a sacrifice is performed, it has three dimensions. One is devata, second is dravya, and the third is dana. Devata means deity, dravya means the material, and dana means giving away. So simply, a yajna is a process where something or the material has been offered to a deity. This is yajna. Always material or ahuti or samidha or samswadha is offered to a deity. So yajna is going on like that, giving away something, and from that in result deity will be giving us something. So simply, in simple word, it is a method of give and take. If Indra is raining, it is giving water to earth. Water on earth is absorbed in the soil, and it gives life to plants. Then plants give life to food. Then food is taken by us. Then again we perform yajna, and Indra is happy. Then again Indra gives us life. So like that, the circle is there, which circle is of give and take, and this is yajna, which is going on all the time. And Vedic ritual should be understood in this way, and this is the hidden meaning of Vedic rituals. Otherwise, there are many rituals, various forms of rituals, Vajasani, Darshpurnamas, Atramani, Ashwamedha, Sarvamedha, Pitramedha, and Vedic texts described about 40 rituals. Some text defines about 48 rituals, some text defines about 25 rituals. But all have different results, different definite influences. A simple Agnihotra is that ritual which is performed by a grahastha, by a householder, thrice in a day. It is a fire sacrifice. So it is only just thanksgiving towards God, towards that Almighty. So Vedic rituals were the first stage in Vedas. And later on, what happened in our Indian culture, in Indian traditions, in Puranas, or later on, we see that there are so many types of ceremonies which people are performing and we are performing. So those are the later development of these rituals, because everywhere we are offering something and in result we are getting something. So this Vedic ritual, which were discussed in the Vedic texts, are actually the roots of later cultural development of India. In Indian continent, we find that people are having various types of ceremonies and festivals and festivities. So all are have their roots in Vedic rituals. Chanting of mantra. This is another aspect, a very important aspect of Vedic religion. A mantra, what is a mantra? A mantra is a sacred verbal formation, because few words are there, but it has a tremendous impact when it is chanted with concentration, when it is chanted with full understanding of its meaning. Always emphasis is there that mantra should be chanted with understanding of meaning, not only speaking of a mantra. Not only repeating all the words all the time will be fruitful. It will not give any result. So meaning is also important, and concentration or meditation is also important, because only then that mantra will be effective, it will be powerful. There are various mantras which are used today as Vedic prayers or Vedic meditation. One of them is Gayatri Mantra, which we have talked about earlier also. Tat Savitur Varenyam Bhargo Devasya Dhimahi Dhiyo Yo Na Prachodayat. So this mantra is a general mantra nowadays, and every Indian or every Hindu thinks or knows about it. So this type of various mantras are there, and chanting is very important for a mantra. And what is the final result of chanting of a mantra? One gets concentrated, its mind is open for consciousness. He will be very, very peaceful. He will be feeling very good inside. So mantra, if meaning is there and understanding is there and concentration and meditation is there, then it will give very, very good results. Mantras are chanted on several important occasions also. Mantras are chanted during marriage ceremonies, during Anteshti Sanskar, during Mundan Sanskar, during Upanayan Sanskar. So these mantras, Vedic mantras, are basis of Indian religion today. In Indian religion, he may be a Bengali or a Maharashtri or a Gujarati, but everywhere Vedic mantras are chanted for ceremonies, for sanskaras. So this is today a very important part, and it is also very important for one's individual upliftment, for one's individual peace. Next is chanting about Om. So this is a sign of Om, and it is a sacred sound of Brahman. Om, like that we say, and repeatedly Om can be chanted. It has very, very effective results according to the Vedic seers, according to the Vedic mantras and Vedic quotations. Chanting of Om is always done before chanting or before pronouncing a mantra. As when I was saying Tat Savitur Varenyam, I should not start like that. I should say Om Tat Sut Tat Savitur Varenyam Bhargo Devasya Dhimahi. So in the beginning of every mantra, Om has to be pronounced, Om has to be recited. This is a fundamental rule. Then before starting of any rites or any ceremonies, Purohit has to chant Om. So this Om is a very small word. Some people say that it is only a letter also, because if it is written like this, it is a letter also, but it is, if it is written Om, then it is a word also, and then it has three sounds, A, U and Ma, and O, A is for Vishnu, U is for Brahma, and Ma is for Shiva. As you all know that Vishnu is for existence of the universe, Brahma is for creation of the universe, and Shiv is for the destruction of the universe. It means Om. Well, while we say Om, we are remembering all the three powers of Brahman: creation, existence and destruction. So it is a very small letter, a very small word, but it is a name. But it is a name of God. It is a symbol of Brahma. It is also called Pranava and Akshara. Akshar means which is imperishable, and Akshar means which is a letter. It is a Parabrahma, name of Parabrahma. Om iti Aksharam Ahu. Om etad Alambanam Param. Etad Gyatva Brahmaloke Mahiyate. There are so many quotations who are praising this sound, and few are listed here before you. Now comes the next concept of social unity. Vedic religion has two aspects, as was told in the very beginning. One is about physical upliftment, about social upliftment, about individual upliftment. So there are various dimensions for the upliftment of an individual. But what about society? Man is a social animal. He lives in a society. He deals with so many persons. He lives in a family. So Vedic religion talks about family peace also, about social unity also. He underlines the concept that there should be social unity, there should be global harmony, there should be always a cordial relationship among all the persons of a group. Only then you can achieve your goal. The group can go up to the goal which they have visualized. So, concept of social unity, that is a very, very important aspect which has contemporary relevance also. People generally talk that Vedas has no relevance today, but it is not correct. Vedas has relevance today also, because they have highlighted about social unity, about global peace, about harmonial atmosphere, about ecological balance. So all these concepts make society a happy society. A unique prayer is given in the Rig Veda, which is Sangyan Sukta. It is the last Sukta of the Rig Veda, which says, Sangachadvam Samvadadham Samvo Manansi Janatam. It is a very famous prayer, and generally schools and colleges use it as their invocation. So this prayer says that you should move together, you should speak together, you should think together. Together means your thinking about a project should be alike. If you will be having different opinion about a project and all are working on it in a group, then you will not achieve your goal. So about a group, when you have to achieve a goal, then you should work in a very cordial relationship. And this is Sangyana. This is anonymity, harmony, unity of thought. The word is given Sangyana, Samyak Jnana, equal knowledge, equal understanding. So this is the concept of social unity. About peace, about social peace, this about progress of society, this concept is always to be underlined, or it should always to be remembered. Then there is a another concept, concept of welfare. The term for welfare is used in the Vedas, that is Bhadra. Bhadra means goodness, Bhadra means welfare, Bhadra means peace. And the other term which everyone knows is Shanti, Shanti, Om Shanti, Shanti, Shanti. So they are asking for peace in the three regions, mentally, physically, spiritually, or three regions on the earth, on the outer space, on the inner space, on the Prithvi, on the Antriksh, on the Akash. So this Shanti, if everywhere will be Shanti, everywhere will be coordination, where thinking will be compact, then we will be having welfare of all. Vedas emphasize for the full span of life. One's life should be of 100 years. Jivema Sharda Shatam. But most important is that life should be full of welfare for others. It should be for others' welfare, for it should be very, very auspicious. So prayers for goodness is in the Yajurveda, which says, Bhadram Karnebhi Shunyam Devaha, Bhadram Pashim, Akshabhir Yajatraha, Isthirai Angai, Tushtvansas Tanubhi, Vyashem Devhitam Yadayuhu. O God, may we listen with our ears to what is good. May we see with our eyes what is good. We may get a long life, a full span of life, which will be very, very beneficial for others. So this is a prayer for the welfare of all. Always, aim is that everyone should be happy, everyone should be satisfied. For this, noble qualities have to be developed. If we will not be having care, feeling of safety for others, then how we can achieve this Bhadrata? So, Bhadrata or the concept of welfare is always underlined there. In prayers, if we will see very minutely, then we will find that most of the prayers of the Vedic seers are in plural. Most of the prayers are in plural. It means they are talking about all the persons. Their prayer is not for one person, for a single person. As we were giving reference of Gayatri Mantra. So the last line of it says, Dhiyo yoh nah prachodayat. Here nah means us. Please grant intelligence to us. So he is not asking for intelligence for myself, but he is asking for intelligence of all. Like that, if he is asking for wealth, then he will say, Vayam syam patayo rainam. We should be the master, we should be the achiever of all the riches. So always we, always us, like that terms are used in the mantras, and this highlights that they were very particular about the welfare of all people, not of only one person. The next concept which we will be discussing here is wish for swasti, means auspicious, favorable, which is good, which is positive. And this term swasti is from two words, su and asti, good and being. So good being is swasti, and swasti vachan mantra says like that, Om swastina indro vridhishravaha, swastina pushaha vishwavedaha, swastina starkshu arishtanemihi, swastino brihaspatir dadhatu. Later on, this swasti was developed as a symbol of swasti, and in Hinduism, it is a very important, very, very sacred symbol. And now, we will be talking about Vedic morals. It is a very general term. Vedic morals are the same morals which everyone knows today. Morality and ethics have not changed. It is an eternal concept. One should speak truth. One should be very particular that he should not speak untruth. Satyam eva jayate, it is our motto. Truth always is victorious. Then one should indulge in studies. Swadhyaya, emphasis is given about swadhyaya. emphasis given about the unity of all human beings. So these are the main principles of Vedic religion, and even today we know all about it. So finally, we can say that Vedic religion is an eternal and universal religion. It recommends rituals for worldly peace. It emphasizes for self-knowledge. It emphasizes on the purity of mind, and all the views of Vedic seers related with philosophy, religion, culture and society constitutes which we say Vedic religion. Thank you.